Good morning. You guys are too sweet. Too sweet. So you're going to need your Bibles. By the way, if you are visiting and don't know me, my name is John Nichols. I have the privilege of serving as the campus pastor here in Elgin and the privilege today of opening God's Word with you. And you are going to need a Bible. We have a few weeks left in our 1 Peter series, and I'm excited to open chapter 5 with you this morning. So go ahead and turn there. And as you're doing it, just kind of a minor recap. If you've not been around, in chapter 4, Peter is writing again to believers. And in chapter 4, he talks a lot about their suffering, a lot about their trials, right? They're being persecuted, right? As the world back then rejected and crucified Jesus, the world was now rejecting the believers in the first century and even persecuting some of them. And so he was writing to them to strengthen them and to encourage them to hold fast to the faith, to keep their eyes on Jesus and to keep going. And if you've experienced any kind of mistreatment because of Jesus, today that does happen. I've experienced it in this world, in this country. If you've experienced any kind of mistreatment, any kind of trial because of Christ, it stinks. It can be incredibly hard. It can be incredibly discouraging. It can bring us to tears. But I think we all would agree that even if it's not related to Christ, right, but just simply being mistreated by a boss or mistreated by a coach or mistreated by a neighbor who's not a Christian, right, it still stinks and it still hurts. But it doesn't compare to being mistreated by your family. I'm confident we would all agree that being mistreated by our family is far worse. To have a spouse, to have a child, to have a parent, to have a sibling mistreat you is far more painful than somebody that isn't a brother or sister in Christ, isn't somebody I know that well, isn't somebody I maybe see that often, but to have a family member do it, it stinks. It's the worst. It's absolutely horrible to be mistreated by a family. You guys, there is enough conflict in the world around us. There is enough conflict that we have to deal with daily in our workplaces and in our neighborhoods and wherever we go, whether it's because of Christ or not. Can we just agree on something here this morning? Can we just agree to not do this to one another? To not mistreat each other? And I'm not saying anybody does this intentionally, but there's enough church hurt that has gone around the world and back. It's not unique to Harvest. See, I'm saying all of this because that's what Peter's getting after. He switches gears significantly in this chapter. And basically is telling them, listen, guys, there's enough junk going on out there. When you come together in here, let's make sure it's not happening. Let's make sure that we are not causing trials for one another and we are not mistreating one another. How do we do this? That's what we're going to look at today. How do we make sure that our actions, our behavior, our words are only building up and only bringing life and health instead of tearing down and destroying? It's a heavy call, it's a heavy message, but it's one that when we lean into can create the most beautiful thing in the world. And you know that even when your family at home, when everything is clicking and you all take that heart of a servant and love one another, it's one of the most beautiful things in this side of heaven. It can be the same in the church and it can have a greater influence on the world around us. So let's dive and dig in. Peter basically is going to unwrap, a charge, a challenge, and a call. That's what we're going to look at. Let's jump in. The first thing Peter unwraps is this, a charge for leaders, right? He says, listen, if we're going to get along in the church and we're going to do this right, it's going to start with the leaders. Let's look at the text, chapter 5, right? So I exhort the elders among you. He's going to talk to the elders first, right? But I want to go back to this word. So, he just said in that one word what I just said in my intro. All this stuff, chapter 4, is going on in the world. The world is mistreating us, so let's make sure we don't. Let's make sure we don't, and it starts with the elders. I exhort the elders among you as a fellow elder, right? Peter was an elder. And as a witness of the sufferings of Christ, as well as a partaker in the glory that is going to be revealed. We're going to stop right there for a second. Peter is appealing to the elders. He's saying, I'm a fellow elder. I'm not bragging. I'm just letting you know. As I speak to you, I'm speaking to me. I was there when Christ was crucified. I watched one of my best friends suffer and die for us. And like you, I'm looking forward to the glory that is ours someday. I'm a partaker in that. We all share in that. Can I encourage you? Right? We're suffering. The world hates us, but glory is coming. Praise God. So he's just appealing to them as a peer and as a brother. He's not trying to domineer over them. He's not trying to lord it over them. He's just saying, listen, you guys are the elders. It starts with you. If we're going to get along, it starts with you. And he uses that word elders. In fact, in this passage, we're going to see three different words that are often used for eldership and summarize what an elder is. The first one is this. It's elders, and it's the word in Greek presbyteros. You don't need to remember that. But this word paints the picture of someone who leads, someone who guides. They're in charge. They're also going to do discipline if it's needed, right? They're kind of the boss. That's really what the picture that word paints. Elders have a responsibility and a duty. And so they need to follow that out. The next words come as we continue from where we left off. Right? We finished here. That is going to be revealed. It says, shepherd, another word, the flock of God that is among you, exercising oversight. This is the verb form. But these are the other two words that are often used for elder. Shepherd is the word poimano, and exercising over it is the word episkopeo. Again, you don't need to remember those. But when you study eldership, it's good to know all three words because they all paint part of the picture. Elders have a huge task. The word elder paints the picture of leading, guiding, and discipline. The word shepherd paints the picture of care, of feeding, of protecting the flock. Right? It's God's people, and that's what we need to do. Remember what Peter was reminded of. Do you know the story? Right, Peter rejected Jesus or denied knowing Jesus right before his crucifixion. Peter who wrote this. So this is very close to his own heart. He denied knowing Jesus when right before Jesus was crucified, but later Jesus would restore him to ministry. And just as Peter denied him three times, Jesus would ask him a question three times. Peter, do you love me? Peter, do you love me? Feed my sheep. Peter, care for my sheep. Peter, shepherd and love and care for my sheep. He's reminding him, Peter, you're not done, Peter. You're going to keep going and you're going to be an elder and you're going to do this. You're going to love my sheep. And exercising oversight is that third word. This paints the picture of governing and looking at the whole picture. Elders have a huge responsibility, but we're talking to leaders as well right now because I believe firmly that if you're in any type of leadership position in this church, you might be leading a D group, or you might be leading children on a Sunday morning, or leading children at Awana, or leading a small group of our students in student ministry. You might be leading one of our community groups. Any way, shape, and form that you are leading, I think all this still applies. Because you in that moment are pastoring, you in that moment are shepherding, and you have a flock that's been entrusted. But look back at this. Shepherd what? The flock of God that is among you. It's God's flock. If you're an elder and you're a leader, the people entrusted to you have been entrusted to you by God, and they are His. They're not yours. They're not yours to do what you want with or to accomplish your will with. They are His, and we're here to accomplish His will, to help them accomplish His will. That's what it is, this picture of leadership to care for, to shepherd, to love, to lead, to guide for the season that you have them entrusted to you. I think I've shared before that I was adopted when I was 3 months old. I spent 3 months in foster care, right? You think of foster care, that's the perfect image in my mind of eldership, of leadership. You've been entrusted with somebody else's soul for a season, somebody else's life for a season. Some of you have participated in foster care. You know, it could be a day, it could be a week, it could be months. Sometimes it could be a year or two. You've been entrusted with that child, that teenager, that baby for a season. To do everything you can to make sure that when they leave your home, they are in a far better spot. They are healthier. They are smarter. They are stronger. They are loved well. They are cared for well. That's the picture here. My parents got me at 3 months old. I was the size of a newborn. I was not cared for well. I only have a few problems that remain. I'm okay, actually. But I wasn't. I was the size of a newborn. I couldn't actually even suck on a bottle. I was so weak. Fortunately, my grandfather at the time was a pediatrician, and he got me all the help I needed and fixed most of my problems. But that's what foster care is. It's to care for. That's what eldership is, right? Really the charge. I said this is a charge for leaders. Here's your charge to those that are under you. Again, whether it's one or three or for the elders that we have in our campus and our church, the thousands. Lead them. Guide them. Teach them. Serve them. Care for them, protect them, and love them, and don't ever stop. That's really what he's saying. When he uses these three words, that's the picture that he's painting. If we're going to get along, if we're not going to mistreat each other, and we're going to love each other well, it starts with you leaders. And this is what you need to do. Because if you're not doing this, it's going to be a mess. It starts here, and you need to do this first. In fact, in Acts chapter 20, he's speaking again about elders. He says, talking to elders, pay careful attention, right? Again, there's the care. Know what's going on to yourselves and to all the flock, in which the Holy Spirit, by the way, has made you overseers. Again, that's one of those words we've talked about. Who puts you in charge? Not you. Holy Spirit raised you up. Pay careful attention to this flock, to care for the church of God, which he obtained. Listen to this. He obtained with his own blood. Maybe a little bit gruesome, but what a great reminder. This church family right here and across our campuses has been bought with the blood of Christ, purchased with the blood of Christ, cleansed with the blood of Christ. We are given redemption and forgiveness because of the blood of Christ. Christ did this. What's going on in this room? Christ did this. Not me, not Pastor Jeff, not any of the staff, not any of the elders. Christ did this. And if you are a leader, don't forget that, because they are his. We are his. This is his. It is not mine or anybody else's. And so care for it well. Love it well. What a gift we have. Elders, leaders, don't ever forget this. You have a charge. Carry it out. Peter continues. We're going to continue with the elders just a little bit longer, the leaders, because he continues. In fact, most of the passage speaks to this group, right? He had said to do all this. We're going to continue in the second part of verse 2. It says, as you do this, as you carry out this charge, as you love and lead and serve, don't do it not under compulsion, but willingly. I love the contrast. As God would have you, not for shameful gain, but eagerly, and not domineering over those in your charge, but being examples to the flock. These are your pitfalls, by the way. If you're in any type of leadership, this is where you're going to be tempted the most. First, to be under compulsion. Well, I'm doing it because I have to. My pastor twisted my arm and put me in charge. If you are in any kind of leadership and it's under compulsion, get out. Stop doing it. Tell me, tell somebody, I'm in here for the wrong reason. I don't feel like I've been raised up by God. I feel like I've kind of been forced to do it. Then get out, because it's not going to go well for you or anybody else. It needs to be a willingness, as God would have you, that God raised you up into this position. You need to know that. You need to be sure of that, because it's going to get hard. If you've ever tried to lead anybody, ask every parent here. Parents, has it ever gotten hard? Yeah, exactly. It's all that. Our kids don't always listen. They don't always obey us. They don't always do what we told them to do. What? Lord, you didn't tell me that was going to be the case. I thought if I had kids, they'd just follow everything I ever tell them. Leadership is no different. That's leadership. Right? You want to lead people. It's not always going to go that way. You need to remember that God raised you up. You need to do this willingly, humbly. God put me here, so I'm going to love and serve and care for, not because I have to, because God has asked me to. And so when it gets hard, I'm not going to give up because God asked me to. The pitfall is to do it under compulsion. The way out is to remember that God asked me to do it and make sure I'm here and serving because God asked me to. The second one was the shameful gain piece. Don't do it for shameful gain, but do it eagerly, right? The picture of shameful gain is exactly what you would imagine. I'm doing it because I want something, right? I was imagining this week, like, the idea of Amy telling me, hey, John, listen, we're going to have our community group over for dinner this Sunday. Would you smoke a brisket? My family bought me a smoker, and I'm having a good time, and I got a really cool brisket recipe. I can't have you all over because it doesn't feed 1,000. So, but she asked, like, would you make a brisket? We'll have community group over. It's going to be great. And I'm thinking, this is awesome. This is great. You know why? Because they're going to come over, and they're going to brag about my brisket. They're going to tell the whole church how good my brisket is. It's so good, in fact, before they get there, I'm going to cut half that brisket off, and I'm going to put it away for me. Because it's so good. I want it for breakfast with my eggs. I want a sandwich the next day. I want leftovers for a week. And if I put the whole thing out, they're going to eat it all. You should see my community group. They can eat. They're going to eat it all, right? I want half for me. Nobody's going to know because I'm going to put it in the fridge. That's shameful gain. I'm looking to get bragged about and bragged on. I'm looking for something for myself. Not really caring to serve my community group. That's shameful gain. I want to get something out of it. If you're in a leadership position and you're looking to get something, get out of leadership. It's not going to go well for you or for anybody else. It has to be eagerly. The picture of eagerly is what I care about is your benefit. your blessing. Eagerly means, hey, Amy, we're having these people over. I got the whole brisket out. There's a whole bunch left over. Here, group, take it home. Give it to your kids. Give it to your friends. Give it away. I don't need it. Take all the leftovers. Take everything out of my fridge if you want it. But that's eagerly. That's what it looks like to eagerly serve. I don't need anything. I don't want anything. I want you to have it all. That's the picture. That's what it looks like. To do it eagerly, earnestly, sincerely. Why? Because I care far more about you than I do myself. I care about your well-being far more than I do my own. Never for shameful gain, but to do it truly eagerly, right? Not I don't want to be eager for any kind of power, eager for any kind of authority. No, not that, but eager to serve. Eager to care for and lead and to help others find and follow Christ. The third warning is the not domineering over those in your charge. Not domineering over those in your charge. Right? This is the idea of lording it over someone, of making people do what you want them to do, or having your own private agenda and manipulating the pieces so you can get what you want done. And you're always right and everybody else is always wrong. Again, if you're in leadership for these reasons, get out. If you're in leadership for selfish reasons because you have an agenda, get out. But instead being examples to the flock. Jesus talked about this. Jesus talked about this in Matthew chapter 20, right? But Jesus called them to him and said, you know that the rulers of the Gentiles, love this phrase, lord it over them. And their great ones exercise authority, basically another way of saying the same thing, over them, right? There's that key phrase, over them, over them. It shall not be so among you. That's how the world does it. And here, we're going to do it differently. Whoever would be great among you must be your servant. And whoever would be first among you must be your slave. Well, that's a little bit different. No lording it over, no dominating, no domineering, no getting what you want. In fact, coming to serve and seek what they want. Even as the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve. There it is again. And to give his life as a ransom for many. You're in leadership, that's your example. Right there. It all comes back to Jesus. This is Jesus' response to the mother of James and John, if you know the story. Towards the end of his life, like, hey, listen, my boys, they're pretty special. I know they're two of your best friends. When you get into glory, can they have your right and left? Can they be right up there ruling and in charge of you? And he's like, you don't get it, lady. You don't get it. I'm here to die. And if they really want to follow me, so do they have to. They have to be willing to die for this whole thing. That's what a servant, that's what a leader does more than anything. That's what a leader does. Leads and guides and loves and cares for. And I love this, the last part of our passage, or the verse we started with. Verse 4. When the chief shepherd appears, right? I don't even know if that's big enough. When Jesus appears, you will receive the unfading crown of glory. Jesus is the chief shepherd. You are in a position of leadership as an elder. You're called a shepherd. You're in a position of leadership. You are shepherding. He's the boss. And what did he do? He came to serve. He came to lay down his life as a ransom for many. He's the one we come under. We're doing it because he raised us up. We follow his example, and we sacrifice, and we serve, and we lay down our lives. If we're going to all get along, this is where it starts. This is where it starts, following Christ and following his example. We lead, we guide, we teach, we serve, we care, we protect, we love, and we do it willingly and eagerly while being example to everyone. That's the charge to leaders in the church. We've got more. Second piece is this, if you're taking notes. It's a challenge for the young. So yes, if you're basically between the ages of 10 and 22, listen up. 10 and 25, and everybody else, because this is for all of us in some level too, but a challenge for the young. Verse 5. Likewise, continuing our conversation, you who are younger, be subject to, there it is, the elders, right? We're talking to the elders. Elders, it starts with you. Leaders, it starts with you. Set an example. Humbly follow Christ's example. If you're young, though, listen up. Be subject to these elders that we just talked to. If the elders are doing their job, they're living out their charge, hey, if you're younger, listen to them. Follow them. Be subject to them. Why are the young singled out? Because in the Greek, this is talking about age. So this is an age thing right now. It's talking to the younger. Why do you think they're singled out? Every parent in the room knows the reason why. Because the younger just often rebel because that's what they do. No matter how much advice you give them, no matter how many times you look at your children and say, don't do this, I did it, and it didn't go well. Doesn't go well for anybody who ever does this. Don't do it. And what do your children do? They do it. That's why singling out the younger folks, right? As a parent, every parent I know swears, I will never say because I said so to my kids. My mom said it, and it drove me nuts. I will never say because I said so to my kids. And then the first time they rebel, because I said so! Right? Yeah, we laugh because we've all done it. And then you realize that's actually a pretty good reason. I'm the parent. You're the child. That's actually an okay reason. Sorry to every teenager in the room. That reason is legitimate. But on the other hand, for those of you in that window, because you're a teenager, you don't get to respond with, well, I'm going to do it anyway. Like, that doesn't go over okay. That never works well for you either. Hopefully you've learned that by now, and we can laugh about it. But there's truth to it. There is truth to it. Those who are younger just naturally tend to rebel. They naturally tend to buck authority and think, I know better. That's really where it comes. I know better than mom and dad. I know better than my boss. They're seeing it a lot with the generation that's graduating college and they're getting jobs and they're looking at their bosses demanding all these things. Like, there's a new guy at the shop. These people have run this company for 40 years perfectly well without this young guy who walks in and goes, you need to change this. I don't like that. I'm not going to do that. No, I'm not going to do that either. I'm taking Fridays off, by the way, right? That works every Friday. No, you're fired. But that's the imagery here. That's why the younger are singled out, because too often they think they know better. And it's the same in the church. Choosing not to submit and to not come under. But I want to show you something else too. Because in the Greek, we're talking specifically to the younger. But I think this can include not just the younger in age, but the younger in spiritual maturity. Because look at what the author of Hebrews said. It's one of my favorite passages to preach out of the book of Hebrews. It says, for though by this time, he's writing to believers saying, listen, you've been believers a long time, 10 years, 20 years, 30 years, 40 years. By this time in your faith, he's saying, you ought to be teachers. You need someone to teach you. Again, the basic principles of the oracles of God. You need milk. Not solid food, right? Again, the imagery right there comes to what? A child, a baby. They have to be spoon-fed because they are unable to feed themselves. Saying, you guys have been around a long time. You've been in church a long time, but you're still having somebody hand-feed you when you should actually be hand-feeding other people. You've not learned. I mean, just imagine. Just imagine having a child who's 18. Just imagine you're in one of those families with like 7 or 8 kids. You got an 18-year-old to a 2-year-old, and you're spoon-feeding the 18-year-old and spoon-feeding the 2-year-old at the same time. Because the 18-year-old refuses to learn how to spoon-feed himself. That's the 18-year-old should be feeding your 2-year-old for you while you're out on the back porch in the lounger. But instead, moms are like, yes. But instead, you're still being fed. For everyone who lives on milk is unskilled in the word of righteousness, since he is a child. And I hate saying this, but it's true. There are some in this room who've been in the church a long time. 10 years, 20 years, maybe you're even older than me. And you're still getting spoon-fed. You've never picked up a spoon. And I share this observation simply because the author did, right? He's comparing you to a child. And what is Peter warning against? Children. Children who don't know better but think they do. These people fall into the same category. And there are some of us in this room who fall into this category. You think you know it all because you've been around, but you've never actually studied the word. You've never picked up a spoon and fed yourself. And so you don't know better. They're often more dangerous, I think, than those that are actually physically younger by age. Either way, it's a warning. It's a reminder. This is a pitfall. This is a thing that can eventually destroy us as a church if the young are not subject to the elders, because that's what we're getting after, right? That's what we're getting after. Be subject to the elders. This phrase isn't new. If you've been around for this series, we've talked about in chapters 2 and 3 that every one of us should be subject to every human institution, that servants should be subject to their master, and that wives should be subject to their husbands. And the picture is choosing to come under the authority that God has raised up. The elders that we have in this church, God raised them up. The leaders that we have in this church, God raised them up. And so I choose, even though it's a command, by the way, too. Being subject to is a command. But I'm going to choose to come under that leadership, trust them and follow them, and trust God and follow them. That's the picture. It's not blind submission. But as the elders faithfully carry out their charge, which, by the way, our elders are killing it. They are a group of humble men who are killing it. So glad to be a part of this team. But we choose to come under them and choose to not fight, not argue, not question everything. By the way, both for the younger generation and my generation, everybody else, we don't have the right to complain. It's not a God-given right. Country might allow us to do it, but we are citizens of heaven and God does not allow it. But we often couch our complaining and our criticism in concern, and it's really not. But the idea is to follow their lead. And actively engaging, by the way. See, there's a passive following. Well, I'm going to follow the elders, but I'm doing nothing. It's not following. Following is actively engaging, actively participating. This is the mission. This is the strategy of the church. I'm in. And I'm going to follow and do my part. That's what he's calling on the younger folks to do. Just because you're keeping your mouth shut doesn't mean you're actively engaging in following. So as the elders and the leaders have a charge, right, to lead well, to love well, to serve well, to care, for those that are younger, you have a challenge. And it's to trust the Lord, trust the leadership he's raised up, and to follow them. Our last piece, if by chance you've tuned out or thought, okay, I'm not a leader, I'm not young, this doesn't apply, now it does. And I think this is the most important piece of the whole message. The rest of verse 5. Clothe yourselves. All of you. With humility. Toward one another. That's a call on every one of us. To clothe yourselves with humility. So I went out and bought something this week. Not just for an illustration, but because it's going to help with the language. Let's see if I can get this on without ruining my mind. See, because the clothe yourselves in the Greek, this is the actual imagery. That word in the Greek, those words in the Greek, the picture painted with clothe yourselves is to pick up your servant's apron and put it on. So just imagine that. Pick up your servant's apron and put it on. All of you. This isn't a pastor thing. This isn't an elder thing. This isn't a younger thing. It is all of those things and everybody else. Everybody in here, if you're saying you are a child of God and this is your church home, this is what you should be doing. This is what I should be doing every single day. Grabbing my servant's apron and putting it on and approaching everybody else with humility. That's the imagery toward one another. So that anytime I come across any one of you in the 7 days of a given week, my first attitude and mindset is, how can I help you? How can I serve you? Just imagine that for a second. I know I look like a goofball, but I'm not taking it off. Because I want you to imagine this. What would your life be like? What would your week be like? What would your home be like? What would our church be like if this is how we approached every day? I'm going to serve you. I'm not coming to you with an agenda. I'm not coming to you with what I think you need to do or what you need to know. I'm not coming to you to vent all of my problems. I'm not coming to you to tell you all the things you need to fix or change about you. I'm not coming with my complaints and my criticism. I'm coming to you to say, how can I serve you? How can I love you in this moment? Just imagine. And I love this church family, and we love well, but this is also something we can grow in. In fact, I know when you talk about humility, the only people who are usually opposed to it are the prideful. Because those of you in this room who get it, and if you know people in this church who are really good at humility, they're always trying to grow more in humility. They're loving this moment. They're like, yes, amen, I need more of it, and you're the most humble person in the room. It's the rest of us, and I stand here as one who I need to grow in humility. I need to do this, and I may take this home and put it on every morning in my quiet time. I don't know what I'm going to do. But if we get this humility piece, everything else works. Everything. Elders, leaders, if you get this piece, you approach every day, how can I serve the people under my care? How can I approach them humbly? All the rest of that is taken care of. If you're young and you take this approach, how can I serve the people? Especially those who are older than me that I think I know more than, but I'm going to shut my mouth and serve them. It fixes everything. I could spend hours on some of these verses alone. But love one another with brotherly affection. And then this, outdo one another in showing honor. That's what this is. I want to outdo you in showing honor. We get together for coffee. I want to outdo you in showing honor in that time we're together for coffee. I run into you in the hallways of the building. I want to outdo you in showing you honor. To approach every person throughout my week this way. By the way, if we're all doing this, because you're thinking, I know often we go, well, John, if that's what I'm all doing, and all I'm doing is caring about everybody else, who's caring about me? Well, if we're all doing this, everybody's caring about you. Everybody's loving on you because you're loving on everybody else too. But that's the picture of the apron, the servant's apron, to clothe yourselves, to put humility on. It's a command, clothe yourselves, but you have to actually do it. You have to get up in the morning. Here we go. I love it. Like, Paul uses this imagery all the time. Put on then. It's kind of like clothe yourselves, right? As God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, compassionate hearts, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience, bearing with one another, and if one has a complaint against one another, forgiving each other as the Lord has forgiven you. So you also must forgive. And above all these, put on, there it is again, that imagery of getting dressed, love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. Throughout the New Testament, throughout Paul's letters and Peter, this imagery of serving and of loving and of caring. It's about taking off my pride first, right? If we're going to put on, if I'm going to clothe myself with this, I'm going to take off my pride. We got to remember, right, my opinions and my preferences, my expectations. I walk into a church, you got to do it my way. I think you should do it this way. Pastor, you're supposed to be treating me this way. I know I never told you that, but I expect this from you. My old church used to do it this way. My parents raised me this way. I have this opinion about something. The gossip, the slander, the self-righteousness, the complaining. That's the stuff that's destroying churches around our country. That's where the division comes from, is all of that self-centered stuff. My way, my opinion, my idea, instead of saying, no, I'm here to outdo you in showing honor. How can I be a part of this church family and just outdo you in showing honor? How can I serve? How can I love? How can I care for? How can I meet your needs instead of my own? To clothe yourselves with humility, to approach every person with the mindset of serving them. And can I just say this too? If you're remotely having the thought that you're above all this, you're not. Jesus, creator of all things, Lord of all things, actually picked up an apron, literally picked up an apron and put it on and washed the disciples' feet. The most disgusting thing you could do in his day as a servant, he did it for all 12. He did it for Judas. If you think you're too high and mighty, if you think you're above and beyond serving, you need help. Because that's what our King modeled to us. That's what our Lord modeled to us. In fact, in that same conversation, he said, I've set an example for you. Do as I have done for you. Pick up your apron and put it on. And last thing I'll say, I'll begin to wrap it up. I always put the pen down. Let's go back to that verse. I always do that. Right? We'd read it. I just want to reread it, right? Clothe yourselves, all of you, with humility toward one another, for God opposes the proud. We don't talk about pride and humility enough in the church. Because pride is a problem. I have a problem with it. And you know what? When I'm prideful, God opposes me. God is against me. Think about that imagery for a second. Just imagine that for a second. That God opposes the prideful. When I was a kid in New Jersey growing up, I was playing football. And my coach, Richie, had us run this drill usually like once a week. It was time to work on our tackling drill. And so the team would line up on both sides, and coach would put a running back or a receiver at one end with the ball and like the defensive guys at the other end. And you got to tackle them. If that running back gets by you, if that receiver gets by you, you're doing push-ups, you're running laps, right? Coach was not happy. Usually he'd say, get up and do it again. You're going to stay there till you tackle somebody. And I used to love the drill. It was fun. These guys were my friends, and I loved the challenge of a kid, maybe a little. I was kind of small and soaking wet. I was like 105. With the pads, I was 110 maybe. But I loved the challenge of trying to tackle a kid who was a little bit bigger than me. And they were all my friends, and it was fun. Well, one day, Coach, for some reason, was in a really, really bad mood. And Richie was about 250 pounds, 6'2", and it was all muscle. He was also my wrestling coach, so we knew each other really well. And I line up there, and my buddy got the ball, and I just was not in a great mood myself. I wasn't doing good, and this kid just ran over me. And Coach, I could tell right away, he just starts screaming, "Nichols, you get up, and if you don't let this next guy go by, oh boy, it's going to come for you. You better get up and stop this kid." I get up, he puts another kid in, hands him the football, and I just got steamrolled. Nichols, that's it, last chance. You miss this one, you're going to run laps till you puke. I'm starting to get a little nervous, but I'm like, okay, I can get this. And then he pushes the kid out of the way, and he steps in the line. "Give me the ball. You ready?" I've never been so scared in my life. Ever. 250 pounds. I said 110 with pads, maybe. I think I was 5'2". I'm like, I tackle him, or I run laps till I puke. They're both going to be miserable. But that imagery, as I was studying this passage, I was like, that flashback came to me. I'm like, oh, man. I was never so scared ever in my life at that moment. And I think, God, that's the imagery here. If you're prideful, this is you. And that's God. God is opposing the prideful. You will fail. You will lose every time. You will. It's God. He opposes. By the way, I did tackle him. I know some of you are wondering. My wife's going, "Did he tackle him?" I know she's thinking it. Yes, I did tackle him, and I hurt for like 3 weeks. But that's the imagery. God opposes the proud. Anybody want to go against God? No, of course not. Like, dumb question, John. No, it's not, but we don't think about it. When we're being prideful, when we're being so forcible with our own opinions and our own ideas, and we're lording it over, or we're not submitting, we're setting ourselves up against God. Why? Because God set all this up. This is His. He bled and died for it. And I don't want to oppose it. As one who needs to become more humble, I don't want to oppose it, but I love this. He opposes the proud, but He gives grace to the humble. It's just the opposite, right? If I'm standing here and Coach Richie's over there, and instead of being prideful, I choose to be humble, the Lord then pushes me out of the way and He goes up against my coach. I remember watching a video of, for those of us that are old enough, the dream team, the original and only good dream team that ever played Olympic basketball. And I remember seeing interviews with Patrick Ewing and all these other players, Larry Bird. And without being asked, every one of them said, "I just have to tell you how great it is to be on Michael's team." They had been against Michael. Some of these guys never won a championship because of Michael Jordan. And they were no longer against Michael. Michael was right there with them on their team. And they blew everybody out. If you're old enough to remember, they blew everybody. It wasn't even a close campaign. But they were so glad to have Michael on their team and not be against him. And that's what the Lord is saying. I give grace to the humble. This is a call for every one of us, guys. If we get this one piece, it will change our lives and our homes and our church like nothing else. It will change the greater Elgin area. If we can clothe ourselves in humility every single day. It's going to come more naturally to some of us. For all of us, including myself, though, we're going to have to work at it. And every day we're going to have to choose to get up and put on our apron and serve others. You know, throughout this series, Pastor Jeff has talked about what he calls stink eye, right? Kind of summarizing what Peter has said, that the early church was dealing with stink eye. They were being mistreated. They were suffering trials because of the world around them. And as I reminded us this morning, there's enough of that going on. So let's not do it to each other, right? Can we agree, elders and leaders, that we will lead well, we will guide well, we will teach well, we will care for and protect and love, never for our own agenda, but always because Christ died for this beautiful family that we have. And for the young, I implore you, learn to come under leadership. Learn to come under authority. Put your pride aside. Stop fighting the Lord. Because when you are fighting your parents, when you're fighting your church leadership, you're actually fighting the Lord. You're going to lose. Learn to come under in an active way and engage with your church. And for every one of us here, I just want to close with these words from Philippians chapter 2. That we would all, this is my prayer and my hope, that we would do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility count others more significant than yourselves. Let each one of you look not only to his own interests, but also to the interests of others. Would you pray with me? Father, as I think over this message, I'm just again reminded, we are here because of Christ. We are here because Christ bled and died that we could be forgiven, that we would be redeemed and bought back and adopted and become children of God, your family, your church, your bride. We are here because of Christ. And I thank you. Thank you for my brothers and sisters. Thank you for the family that we get to live life together with. What a gift this is. And God, I pray that you would protect us from the world around us, that we wouldn't be a people who would have to endure suffering and trials from the world, but knowing that when it comes, you will give us the strength and the courage and all we need to face it. But even more so, I pray that in here, inside these walls and in our homes, when we are together, God, we would love well, all of us, leaders and young and every one of us, that we would love well, that we would clothe ourselves with humility every day, that we would outdo one another in showing honor, that we would never do it for shameful gain, but we would do it eagerly and willingly, being examples to one another. God, would you change us and thus change our family from the inside out as you grow us in these things, God? Let us leave here transformed and different from what we've heard this morning, I ask and I pray. Jesus, make us like you. Make us like you, that we would serve and sacrifice just like you did. A great and awesome Lord and Savior who gave it all for us. Make us like you, Jesus, I pray. Amen.